Hi, Chuck Huber here for the Stata YouTube channel. Today I'd like to show you an item response theory model called a nominal response model, or NRM for short. These are useful models when we have questions that have multiple possible responses and none of them are really correct or incorrect and they're not ordered. They're simply just a collection of possible responses. So for instance, we might have a question like, choose your favorite topic in science class. The responses could be 1 is geology, 2 is astronomy, 3 is biology, or 4 is chemistry. None of them are right or wrong, and they're not in any particular order. We would just like to know the probabilities of answering with any particular category. So let's look at an example. I'm going to web use a data set called science. And let's describe these very quickly just so we can take a look and see what's in the data set. We have 4 questions numbered Q1 through Q4. And if I tabulate question 1, for example, I can see that there are 4 possible outcome categories. So this might be a question like the one, our science question. So we can fit a nominal response model by going to statistics, scrolling down to IRT, item response theory. And I'm going to move this up to the side here. And for the model, I'm going to select model and then choose nominal response models, NRM, then select my items, which are Q1, Q2, Q3, and Q4. And then I'm going to fit the model. Click Fit Model. The state is fitting the model. And in the results window, I can see the command here at the top is IRT with the option NRM for nominal response model, followed by a list of the questions or items. Next, we see our iteration history, and I'm going to click More so that we can see our table of coefficients. Let's just focus on question 4 here. Notice that for each of the questions, I have 3 discrimination parameters and 3 difficulty parameters. This is because I have a parameter that compares group 2, or the response category 2, versus response category 1. And then the second row here, I'm going to have category 3 versus category 1. And then the third row here, I have category 4 versus category 1. So here everything is being compared back to the referent category group 1. Same thing for the difficulty parameter. I'm comparing, I have a parameter that compares group 2 versus group 1, 3 versus 1, and 4 versus 1. Now, it's a little easier to interpret these, at least to me, by looking at graphs. So I'm going to go back to the control panel here, and I'm not going to look at reporting for this one. I'm just going to skip to graphs. And I'm going to begin with the category characteristic curves, or CCCs. And it's a little easier to look at these one item at a time. So I'm going to select question 1 and click submit. And now on my graph, what I see are 4 curves. The first one here, the blue curve, shows us the probability that someone responds with category 1 as conditioned on theta. So this blue line here is relatively flat. It seems to peak around theta equals 0. The maroon line, or kind of reddish maroon line here, is the probability that someone responds with category 2. And I can see up here in my graph that that is fairly low when theta is low, when we have a low value of theta, but that probability increases for increasing values of theta. Similarly, the green line starts a little higher and decreases with increasing values of theta, and the probability that someone responds with category 4 also starts a little higher than 0.5 for low values of theta and decreases as theta increases. Okay. Let's go back to our control panel and look at item characteristic curves. These are sometimes called boundary characteristic curves in this particular case. So let's look at a boundary characteristic curve and see why they might be called that. In this case, we're looking at the probability that someone responds with a greater than a particular category. So for instance, the blue line represents the probability that someone responds with category 2 or greater. So this is category 1 versus category 2, 3, and 4. And we can see that that probability is generally increasing as theta increases. The red line here represents the probability that someone responds with categories 3 or 4 as compared to categories 1 or 2, and that probability starts fairly high and decreases as theta increases. And then lastly, we have the probability that someone responds with category 4 versus categories 1, 2, and 3, and again, that probability is decreasing as theta increases. As with other kinds of item response models, we can look at item information functions. So I'm going to select that and click submit. And as is typical, we see that most of the item information function, the item information is highest near value, theta values of 0, because we don't observe a whole lot of individuals with very high or very low theta values. We can also look at the test information function for the entire test, all of the items. So I can select that, and again, we see this pattern where most of the test information is near theta equals zero. And I can also plot the test characteristic function. So I'm going to select that and click submit. And this will map my latent variable theta back to the expected test score. Remember that we had four questions scored 1, 2, 3, and 4. So the possible test scores could be 4 if everyone if someone answered 1 for all four questions, versus 16 if someone answered 4 for all four questions. And here we see the range of expected test scores from 9 to 13. Okay, so that's how we can fit nominal response models using Stata. I hope this was helpful. Thanks for stopping by.